Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of the LitRPG podcast. I'm Ramon Mejia. I'm here to bring you the latest LitRPG news, reviews, and of course author interviews. This is episode number 161 of the show, and I have five new LitRPG titles just for you folks at home. And that includes Shadow Sun Survival, Shadow Sun Book Number 1, written by Dave Wilmarth, a community favorite. We also have Viridian Gate Online, Firebrand, a LitRPG adventure, the Firebrand series, Book Number 1, another expanded universe series for the Viridian Gate Online universe. Then we also have Cat's Quest, Book Number 1. This is a translated novel from Russian, so fans of those are going to enjoy this. Then it's going to be Small Medium at Large. This is actually the second book in this series by Andrew Sippel, who wrote the Threadbare series. This is a story that's set in that same universe, different main character, same RPG rules. So there you go. And then last but not least, Awaken Online Dominion, which has been doing super well on the Amazon charts, which we'll get into that later. But first, we're going to go into Lit RPG News. And in Lit RPG News, we're going to begin with some wonderful fan art for the Ascend Online series, including commission work and some fan art. Luke Chmielenko, the author of that series, was kind enough to share that on his author page and his fan page. The first one is so awesome. Like, I'm genuinely like awed by the amount of detail in this one. I'm pulling it up on the video version of the podcast, of course, but you definitely check, like, there's so much amazing detail. It reminds me kind of the Final Fantasy artwork that you see in the cover arts, just because there's a lot of metal, a lot of small little disc stuff. And some people's clothing just looks like it's really put together, like it's actually crafted like customly, which is a big part of that particular story universe. So great things there. And then there's also some fan art from Lunar Lilith, which looks like just more like CGI 3D modeling stuff for several characters. Still nice. Looks like it came out straight out of MMO, which is kind of the point of that particular novel. So really good stuff there. So definitely go check it out. Have a link in the show notes for the author's fan page. Okay. Also in LitRPG News, we have Michael Chatfield, who recently did a Facebook live stream where he outlined some of his publication goals and has some updates where his series are and where they're going to be released at potentially. He includes a pre-order link for the Fourth Realm book, which will be out on March the 22nd. So just in a couple of weeks here, that pre-order is out. He's finishing up. Apparently he said in the stream, he rewrote like 200 or 300 pages worth of that story. And it's really long at this point. I think he said it's somewhere like 600 pages. So that Fourth Realm book is going to be super meaty and chunky. He also mentioned there are some, issues with like audiobook versions, like the first book in the 10th Realm series is out. The second book, it's in Audible's hands. So fans of that particular series have audiobooks. We also have some news there. He also talked about a bunch of other projects, recommendations. It was a fun little Facebook live stream. Okay. That's it for LitRPG News. Short and sweet this week. Also out now, we have some stories that came out recently. I haven't had a chance to review them, but they came out, including Black Turtle, the Artar Chronicles book number 2. This is another, translated book from Russian. This one's about, a monk. So it's MMO. The main character chooses a monk character class, and there's some fun slice of life adventures there. I enjoyed book number 1, so I'll have to wait to see book number 2. Also out is Changing World, The Fast Flow. I missed a beat here. Like, the first book in the series came out a while ago. I enjoyed it. The second book came out on February 21st, and I just didn't know. Apparently it didn't show up on my Amazon search results for LitRPG or Game Lit or anything like that. So it's out. I'm just letting you know about it in case you enjoy the first book. So there. Also out is the fifth book in the Endless Online series, called Oblivion's Crown. I know that author has a ton of fans who've enjoyed his works. Book number 5 is out. Go enjoy it. Stuart Gross's 20th volume in the Rules Free VR Mobile Life series, which is like shorter stories, a little more adult-oriented. So there's that for those fans of that series. The 20th book, Ascension, is out in that particular series. The third book in the Bushido Online series is out, called War Games. So if you're a fan of that series, that one is also out for you. So all kinds of good stuff for people who are fans of series. I'm just letting you know, this is out. I'm not going to review some of these things. There's, I didn't enjoy them enough, or I just fell off the series wagon and I can't catch up, and I can't read the newest ones until I catch up on the older ones. But fans of the series should know these are out if you like them. We have some new LitRPG audiobooks as well, including Pangea Online Book 2, Magic and Mayhem. I enjoyed both books 1 and 2 in that series. Siphon by Magic Drum Books, published by Magic Drum Books, written by Jay Boyce, is out. I had a good time with that particular first novel. Few issues, but you can read the review on that if you want to go check it out. But the audiobook is out now. Also, this, I want to say this is the 7th book. I forgot to write it down. The Realm of Archon series is out as an audiobook, The Mist of Arantia. So that is out. And that's it for LitRPG audiobooks. On to upcoming LitRPG stuff that I know is coming out in the near future. You guys can feel free to skip it if you want to, but it's just me reading off a bunch of names and release dates that I know about from authors or from pre-orders or from things like that. On March 11th, it'll be Dungeon World, a Dungeon Core Experience by Jonathan Brooks. He's actually been doing quite a few Dungeon Core stories recently. So we'll have to wait to see this one turn out. This is apparently a new series, though, for him. On March the 14th, another Viridian Online expansion novel is called Vindication, The Alchemic Weaponeer, with a main character you might or might not recognize, but that'll be out on March the 14th. March the 18th, Absolute Zero, Adam Online Book Number 1, written by Max Lagno. He's the co-author for the Level Up Knockout series, so if you like that, you might like this as well. On March the 19th, Protectors, Evolution Online Book Number 5, that is a Dungeon Master story, so go check that out, is the 5th book in that series. March 22nd, it'll be the 4th Realm. That was, again, the new bit of news from Michael Chatfield. The 4th Realm in the 10 Realms series, book number 4, out on March 22nd. There is an actual pre-order. On March 25th, The Final Trial, Level Up, book number 3 is out. March 27th, Dark World Transformation, book number 3. March 28th, the second book in the Illusionist series, Viridian Online, The Dead Man's Tale. On April the 11th, Into the Game, Dungeon Crawl Quests. I genuinely hope this isn't an April Fool's joke. It is out on April 1st, though. If it is, they got me for like a month or more. But it actually looks like a really potentially interesting story to me. On April the 5th, it'll be Djinn Tamers, a Rivals, the second book in that series. It'll be April 10th for Edge of the Abyss, Respawn Trials, book number 1. On April the 11th, the 5th book in the Good Guys series called Dukes and Ladders. April 16th, Soul Catcher. On April 18th, Dragonheart. On April 22nd, Class A Threat, Discardium, book number 1. This is by the same author of the Level Up series. I talked to him as an author interview not that long ago. He talked about this one. Actually seems to be really more interesting than the cover art and the novel description hint at. On April 25th, In Search of Olden's Galacticon, book number 2 by Vasily Mahenko. On June 1st, this one's new, Realm of Noria, book number 2 called The Life. So I feel like the first book in that series, book number 2, will be out on June 1st. And that is as much as I know, as far in the future as I know. There you go. On to new releases and reviews. And into new releases and reviews, all the reviews we have this week for you folks. And first one is going to be Shadow Sun Survival, Shadow Sun book number 1, written by Dave Wilmarth. We have it at 404 pages, $3.99. It is available on Kindle Limited, and here's the author's description. How well would you fare if the apocalypse fell upon you? Could you survive more than a few days? Would you be able to feed yourself, find clean water, safe shelter, or heal your wounds? Alistair is a gamer geek who has spent most of his life indoors playing virtual reality MMORPGs and reading classic lit RPG books. But when Earth is seized by an ancient race wielding incredibly advanced tech, who transport the entire planet to a new location with twin suns, he finds himself fighting to survive in real life. The human race is declared a contaminant, and the new overlords decree that 90% of us will be exterminated. Creatures out of myth and legend are sent to do the killing, dragons, titans, alien creatures, big and small, all with the hunger for human flesh. Humans who survive the first year will be rewarded. After seeing his family killed in the first week, Alistair leads a small group of survivors in their struggle to stay alive. Not satisfied with simple survival, he strives to make himself and his people stronger. The new magic RPG system that now governs the planet is something he can work with and teaches others to exploit. Thrust into a leadership position and with a vengeance in his heart, Alistair aims to establish a stronghold, then take the fight to the monsters who seek to enslave his people. So So there you go. Not a bad description of either the premise or like essentially kind of the bigger points in the story. This is a slice of life RPG apocalypse story with town building and community building aspects that set up a bit like System Apocalypse, in that aliens have started the RPG apocalypse, but in this case, humanity is being targeted specifically with the goal of reducing their population by 90% by spawning monsters everywhere. Also, humanity has 1 year to try to survive and claim any territory on Earth before the other aliens come to immigrate. The story plays out very much in a slice of life story way. I actually had a really good time with this. I should disclose that I did a minor bit of beta reading for this story when it was still in production. So I put that bias aside. I've seen some of the changes going into the story. And I actually like this version quite a bit more. In the beginning of the story, the author does a really good job of presenting the new rules, because they're a little bit different than the traditional MMORPG rules that you see in a lot of stories with like specific stat definitions and specific numbers. But thankfully, the author does a good job of explaining what those differences are and how they're affecting this particular story in the very beginning of the story. But for most of the novel is really just a slice of life RPG apocalypse story. And so you get the main character recounting the first days of the RPG apocalypse, how he had an edge on the system since he's an RPG game lover. There's some storylines with why the new apocalypse has RPG rules and how it relates to like humanity's, you know, interest in RPG games as relating to the alien stuff a little bit. I don't want to spoil that for you. But a lot of the story is just about him surviving, gathering resources and survivors to figure out how to make a place for this war in this world. When there are so many deadly monsters who are just trying to murder everybody, and how all those monsters are just higher level than everybody else. And you know, how you're trying to strategize to survival with taking risk to gain experience points and resources, and how there's that balancing there. A lot of the story does a really good job of showing these survival aspects of like an apocalypse story, and still incorporating good game mechanics that make sense without like sacrificing the survivalist stuff. The game mechanics and story are similar to what you see in some RPG aspects. Again, with the qualification that some of the numbers are very specific to this story, and the author does explain how those numbers change. That was probably one of the biggest notes I have for this. Like, wait, why aren't like strength and intelligence that just 10 automatically as a base number? And the author actually went into the story and changed. I was like, oh, here's why, Ramon, practically in the beginning of the story saying, oh, no. And so besides that, though, like you'll see a lot of like commonalities, like, oh, regular stats, status screens, character sheets, experience points, item descriptions for some items. I wish I would probably seen more things, but the author explains why everything doesn't get item description necessarily, or it start have like damage notifications. There's spells galore, there's loots, there's also a crafting system in there. But I think the most unique game mechanic is probably going to be the biggest seller for the series is going to be the town building stuff and the base building stuff. It's good crunchy details. It reminds me a little more of like real-time strategy games where you have options to build automatically without having to like have people actually construct it, but like you're seeing these wireframe outlines and you can expand based on the resources you've gathered and the population and making sure everybody's happy and all that good stuff. I think that's going to be the most unique selling point for this series and this novel in particular, and because it expands on that in a way that other RPG apocalypse stories haven't. And so if you're a fan of town building, you're a fan of like community building and kingdom building kind of stuff, I think this is going to be like a really big selling point for you as far as your reading goes. Overall, though, there's still good action adventure. There's still like good like smaller stories with the main characters just fighting. Lots of adventure stuff in here. Lots of a good variety of monsters that are not just pulled from necessarily other like fantasy stuff, like from mythology, but they're also twisted. And there are some unique monsters that I thought, oh, this is, I hadn't thought of like twisting the monster that way. That's kind of really neat. But again, also with the aspect of survivalist stuff in there, that is a big seller for like the people who like apocalypse kind of stories. Also, there are some real risks in the story where some characters are going to die permanently. So it's a little, you know, grimdark in that respect. Like, oh yeah, anybody in the story can absolutely die. There's no one who's safe. I'm assuming you maybe in the main character, depending on how the mechanics go in the future. But there's still good character development between those characters as well. So I had a good time with it. Gets a score of 7.4 to 10. Again, fans who love RPG apocalypse stories, people who love beast building, kingdom building stuff are all going to really enjoy this, I think. I did. So there you go. Shadow Sun Survival, Shadow Sun book number one with a score of 7.4 out of 10. I think it's the best score of the episode. Okay. On to our next book is going to be Viridian Online, Firebrand, a Little Bit Adventure, the Firebrand series book number one, written by J.D. Astra. I think there's also a, on the Amazon part, it says James Hunter. There you go. Okay, it is 295 pages, $4.99. It is available on Kindle Unlimited. Here's the author's description. New worlds get new kings, and that's exactly what Abby thinks she's found in her boss's hacked code. With a cataclysmic asteroid careening towards Earth, the VR MMORPG project Viridian Gate Online has become more than just a game, and Abby thinks her boss, Robert Osmark, wants to be more than just its founding father. Now, Abby holds a hacked key to the kingdom that could earn her a punishment worse than death. To uncover the secret that drug lords and corrupt politicians paid millions for, Abby must dive into the game she helped create and team up with one of its AI creations. It's a race against the clock as she tries to discover what's hidden in the secret code before Osmark can crown himself, ruler over all that remains of humanity. So there you go. And again, this is an expanding universe novel. It's written by somebody else. She's not Jamie Hunter, I think. And it's just, this is actually a main character that is going to be familiar with anybody who's read the main VGO series for Abby. She was very prominent in especially in the first book in that series. And she has her own series now. The story essentially follows Abby's search for what Osmark has hidden in the game, her class quest, the events, and some of the events in the main video series up until the point where Grimjack gets the Imperial Seal. And that's kind of where the novel ends. It's a little bit spoilery, but a lot of the novel is going to be spoilery if you've already read the main video series. And that's kind of the point where the story loses me, unfortunately. It's where the novel doesn't work for me, unfortunately. There are generally new adventures. There's new class information for the main character's particular class. That's it. The Firebrand class is new. And as are the details in some of the adventures. But like all the major plot points, I'm like, I know what's going to happen. I know where like her adventures are going to go as far as her search for, the hidden secret. I'm like, I know what that hidden secret is. I read the main VGO series. I think this might be a fine novel if you've not ever read anything else in the Rooting It Online series. Like this will feel more surprising and it'll feel more tense. But anybody who's ever read the main video series, like nothing's really going to be super surprising here. I mean, like there's going to be little elements of like the action adventure stuff as the main characters are kind of growing that are going to be interesting. And there's definitely some interpersonal thoughts for the main character where she's expanding her viewpoint of like, oh, these aren't just pieces of code. They feel like regular people. But outside of that, like anything to doing like big plot points, I'm like, yeah, I know what's happening. I've read the series already, and her interactions with it, and that is not going to change because that's already like hard coded into the main series, and so there's not much room for them out there to wiggle room with this particular character. I think the other expanding universe novel had kind of an advantage because it was set before the main series even started, like a year in advance, and so that story has an opportunity to tell really original stories and do things that aren't necessarily going to be bound by the main series. But when you take a character like Abby, who's already in the main series and we know what she's going to do, we know where her plot kind of goes, and you give her an independent story, that story is very much restricted into where it's going to go because the canon has already been established. And so that one's really bound a little bit more into what it can do and where it can go. So that's why I just didn't really look for me. And I kind of had the same thoughts about, I think, the author's story when she wrote for the Viridian Online anthology series. I felt like, I know what's happening in this story. I know the events, so it's less of a surprise and it's less over because nothing's really feeling super new. And that's kind of what I feel about this one as well. So I know there are a lot of other Viridian Online fans who enjoyed this, who like seeing more about this particular character. It just didn't resonate with me enough to be good. It's not bad, though. Like, nothing in the story is bad. Action is still there. The Firebrand class stuff is still there, and it's neat. It's just, like, overall, I was like, oh, it just didn't really work for me. So it gets a score of 6 out of 10 for me. That's for Viridian Gate Online, Firebrand, a lit RPG adventure, the Firebrand series, book number one, with a score of 6 out of 10. I think it's the only book in the entire Viridian Gate universe that just didn't quite get a 7 out of 10, at least for me. So, yeah, it is what it is. Nothing bad here, though. I don't want to think that it's bad in any way, shape, or form. good writing, academic adventure stuff, just didn't work for me. Okay, on to our next review. It's going to be Cat Quest, book number one by Roman Prokofiev. Cat Quest, book number one. There you go. It's 377 pages, $3, I'm sorry, $2.99. It is available on Kindle Unlimited. Here's the author's description. When a tricky merchant player called Cat finds a mysterious magic sword, it quickly draws the attention of both the administration and the other players inside the virtual reality of top-of-the-line full-immersion MMORPG. This discovery sets off a special event and starts a deadly intercontinental war, all arranged by long-gone developers. Now Oleg, the man behind Cat, has to collect all the unique weapons left in the game by its creators before the tragic accident claimed their lives, and to complete the new challenge that nobody on the new developer team has any idea about, all the while being accused of cheating and hunted by the most dangerous guild in the world, in the game world, led by a dark goddess and one of the top PvP players. Once he was a professional player earning real money in another game, he fell from his pedestal to a debt pit. His account got blocked, his savings got burnt, and his friends left him behind, and dangerous people appeared at his doorstep wanting their money back. To get back on his feet, he decided to enter a new game and find a new source of income. Okay, I'll be honest, that novel description is a little mixed up. And it doesn't really do... It's actually describing the series as a whole, but also part of the story. And actually, it's spoiling some of the main plot points of this book, which should have been a surprise. The portion about once a professional gamer, at the very end of that novel description, that's actually the beginning of this novel. So why it's at the end of that novel description, I don't know, but it is there. And the rest of it about, like, him discovering that magic sword, that's actually a major plot point in the story that's completely spoiled. And the rest of it is like, oh, that's a series description, not necessarily this particular novel. So it is what it is. I'll give you a different description, I guess. This is translated from Russian. It's a story that reminds me a bit of the second Way of the Shaman series, where things start to, remember the second book in the Way of the Shaman series, where it's less about the individual small story of the main character, and more about like him expanding into guild politics. That's a lot of what the story is here as well. It starts out very early on with the main character, with the like motivation for the main character to switch games. You learn that the main character earns his living by trading and by like essentially doing gold farming in some ways, like doing trades to earn game gold and then transferring that into real money or selling that game gold for real money, all of that kind of stuff. And then you learn in the beginning of the story, and this is not spoilery, it's said in the novel description, he loses his account. His account is actually blocked because a different game company saying he's a cheater there, and so he loses his ability to make money. And so to keep his bills paid, to keep his wife happy, to keep his the way he likes to live, he has to switch games, and he goes into this game, which is where he's going. But he has to figure out the rules, has to figure out how this system works. And that's a lot of the early part of the story, where he's trying to figure out, oh, how to recruit my character, what are the mechanics here, what are the guild politics like, what are the trade mechanics like, how can I still make a living, essentially buying and selling items in different marketplaces in the game world, and what are the in-game mechanics of their economies, and how does that work? And a lot of it is like this build of like, oh, I can do this. And then it turns about 30% of the way story, it kind of shifts a little bit to more of a traditional chosen one-ish kind of story, where he finds this magical sword that he's just unable to identify, but it gives him like these super OP powers for a little bit. And the game developers are like, oh, we're getting complaints because this thing is overpowered and we feel like it's maybe a good spirit. We can't actually delete it. So if you keep using it, we're going to ban you potentially. And so the main character has a kind of balance like, oh, the sword is really saving my butt from PvP characters, PvP players. And how am I going to balance that with me trying to earn a living by, you know, gathering resources, doing crafting and trading on the open market so that he can make a living. And so there's several aspects of the story that I think were really interesting. One is the kind of OP character story arc, which becomes more OP as the story goes on. Like, as the story goes on in that respect, like there's introduction of like guild issues, guild versus guild combat, player versus player combat, even realm versus realm combat. So like it's really epic by the time the story like gets really going. By the 3/4 mark, it's like super big and epic in a lot of respects. But at the same time, there's a lot of interesting stuff with the merchant trading system, with like... it's a lot of explanation about trade schemes, local marketplaces versus rural marketplaces. Like there's like I feel like there's like a mini course in how to be an online trader, game mechanic creator. Like if in some respects that was really neat. I just wish it was better developed and there was more of it. And like that was the emphasis of the story. I think I would have given it an even better score if that was the case. But again, this is a novel that's been finished for a really long time. It's translated to English, so it's kind of already set in stone. But again, there's enough of there that's keeping me interested. A lot of the story feels like it's very slice of life, with mixed in with like these larger guild complex for most of like the mid and late storyline points. So a lot of good stuff. Be aware that the story does end on kind of a cliffhanger. Again, it's teasing you into book two, but some people, it's going to bug some people. It didn't bother me. It's just like making you aware in case that bothers you. For me, I had a good time with it. Gets a score of 7.4 out of 10. That's Cat's Quest book number one with a score of 7.4 out of 10. So there you go. Okay. Next, we have Small Medium at Large by Andrew Sipple. This is actually the second book in the Small Medium series. It is 332 pages, $4.99. It is not available on Kindle Unlimited. Here's the author's description. It's tough being a country girl in the big city, especially when werewolves are murdering their way through the underworld. Chase Barrymore must bring all her divination skills to bear in order to catch both the wild werewolves and murderous mafiosos. She's got a shot at finding steadfast allies along the way, but at great cost. The mysterious entities that call themselves players are involved, and where they go, chaos follows. And this is as the sequel to the new LitRPG saga, Small Medium at Large, serves upon a large helping in action, cunning plans, and mystery. And all that's super true. You might remember Andrew Sipple's name. He's the author of the Threadbare series, and this story is actually set in the same universe. It has the same game rules and the same like game restrictions and stuff, class stuff. But this is a different main character. You might see like the crossover like one particular golem character, but that's kind of it. And this story is definitely going on its own story path. When I read book one, I wasn't sure whether or not this was going to cross over with that Threadbare universe. And in book two, it definitely doesn't. It continues on doing its own thing, and that's not necessarily bad. But if you're expecting like the Threadbare main character to show up, he's not in this story. He might in the future at some point, but right now this is definitely its own thing. And that's not, again, not necessarily bad. Just manage your expectations. For me, I actually like this story quite a bit. It keeps all the good action adventure that you saw in book one going, but this time it actually adds a kind of investigation mystery aspect that I thought was really neat, especially as the main character isn't really combat focused. Like she's an oracle. We get to give her like some unique class powers to like see into the future potentially for like 10 seconds. And then if she wants to follow that path, great. But if she chooses to veer off from that path, she suffers these feedback issues. And she also has a bunch of other like kind of fortune telling aspects that give her hints as to what's being true, what's potentially in the future. And that kind of changes and gives her options as to how she's going to act or find information to like solve this mystery. And it's a really good combination of like this mystery story with like her using her abilities in very unique ways to like beat these like much more powerful characters in the story. And I really liked the use of these like RPG game powers. And of course, there's plenty of RPG character progression in here galore. And like all the stats are really weaved into the whole world building system. Really good stuff. It was really fun to see this like small, like literally halfling character, who I think is called something at like the race is called something in the novel, but it's a halfling. Again, just outwit her opponents and use her non-combat skills to get an advantage. And it's like good action about yourself all the way through a really enjoyable story. Get to source 7.3 out of 10. That's Small Medium at Large. Had a good time with this. That's 7.3 out of 10. So there we go. Go check it out. Next. Okay. Next and last is Awaken Online, book four in the series, Dominion. It is 690 pages, $6.99. It is available on Kindle Unlimited. Here's the author's description. The fourth installment in the best-selling Awaken Online series. Following Jason's evolution into a keeper, he finds his fledgling city once again in turmoil. A new and deadly enemy threatens the Twilight Throne, one that is no difficult contending with Jason and the members of Original Sin. Jason must work quickly to consolidate his city's power. That means securing the villages within Twilight Throne's influence, finding a steady stream of income, and growing the city's military strength. Even as the group grapples with these changes, they notice that something is stirring up the native undead around the city, although the source of the strange influence is uncertain. One thing is clear, however, Jason might have evolved, but his enemies have adapted with him. If the Twilight Throne is to survive, the group must grow stronger, and Jason must learn to control his newfound abilities. Okay. Overall, this is still a very good, interesting story. However, I found portions of it a little predictable. The reviews for this novel are almost entirely positive, though. Like, most people probably don't care. They have a really good time with this. I think it's like 90% five stars reviews, like a few more percentages, four stars, and then a couple, you know, like any novel series, one or two star reviews. And this thing has been sitting on the top 100 on Amazon, all Amazon, for more than a week. So there's a lot of fans who love the story. There's a lot of fans who've been reading it voraciously. Even now, I think the highest it got was maybe the top, like sub 20, I think. Might have even been a better, have been watching it, you know, hour, but checking on a semi-regular basis. But this has been doing super well. So first, congratulations, Travis Bagwell, for writing another amazing novel that people seem to really love. For me, though, certain aspects started to get a little predictable, and most of those are in the in-game story lane. I don't want you wrong. Nothing in this story is bad. Nothing's like badly written in any shape or form. There's still good lots of action adventure. There's a great grand battle scene at the end of this story, which is kind of a happens in every single book of the novel, like this huge grand climactic, you know, battle scene that everybody seems to enjoy and love. However, this time the story is in-game villain. It felt a little, I don't know, he felt a little monster of the week. That's how I'll describe it. Like, if you ever like seen superhero shows or comic books, you'll know that sometimes villains just show up that don't really have like a long plot line. They're just there to challenge the main character, like to beat them down and to show them they're weak and force the main character to train and power up and level. And then the main character refights that main bad guy and he beats the heck out of him. And that's kind of what this monster, the villain in the story, feels like to me. And that's not necessarily bad. It feels very like Dragon Ball-esque and part of the storyline. And I personally love the training scene. I really liked the training scenes aspect of the story. I think that was probably the strongest part of the in-game storyline. But the rest of it was like pretty predictable. I'm like, oh, okay, I can see where this is going. This new villain, which I've never heard of, never has been hinted at before, shows up. And, you know, he's just there as the goal line for the main character to power up and level and to beat at the end. And that he serves that purpose. So there was nothing wrong with that. I like Dragon Ball Z. I like that aspect, but it was a little predictable in that respect. The real life storyline for me in this instance was actually more interesting than the game line one. Mostly because I got to see some actual resolutions of the main character's feeling towards his parents. I got to see some emotional resonance from him and some actual follow through on that teased out plot line for like three other books. But like, oh, how the world is going to be kind of dealing with like this emergent AI thing. And I liked that aspect. It was definitely, for me at least, again, less predictable in what the actual resolution was for that, for as compared to the in-game storyline. There are a few things that actually annoyed me here. And again, they're minor, super minor complaints. The Jason Riley love thing, I'm like, this is book four. This should have already been resolved. And there's just like this early part of the story where it was just super bothersome. It's just like this misunderstanding, and it creates this tension, this conflict between the character. I'm like, it just felt forced. Because I mean, I know from a storytelling point of view, it exists there so that when it's resolved later, it feels like an emotional release in some respect. The setup for that just felt a little bit forced. And then I'm not the only one who thought this. Just reading through the reviews, there are quite a few of the people who felt the same way. But again, super minor thing. The other thing that kind of bothered me was the Alexion villain thing. He's feeling super weak. I'm not really sure why he's even there anymore, except that was built up as like the super big series villain for the series. It just felt like all of his wins are super easy. He doesn't really have to work for anything. He's not actually the one doing any of the work at this point for those wins a lot of times. And I'm like, oh, okay, it felt like a weird aspect of it to me. But other than that, those two minor things, there's nothing really to complain about. Just a lot of it was just for the in-game side. I'm like, a lot of it was like really kind of just predictable-ish. Overall, still a really good story. I think most fans of the series have spoken with their dollars and spoken with their reviews and how much they've enjoyed. I think most fans who've enjoyed these books will still enjoy this. But for me, again, a little predictable. Doesn't mean it's bad. I still had a good time with it. Gets a good score for me. Just not as good of a score as I've had for other books in the series. For me, gets a score of 7.2 out of 10. That's an Awaken Online Dominion with a score of 7.2 out of 10, which is still a good score. And that's it. show is done. Finito. Short. I mean, 5 bucks only. That's it. You can follow us on Facebook, folks. You can follow us on Twitter, YouTube, Patreon, our webpage. I actually want to ask you, if you want us to help support the podcast this week, go subscribe to us on YouTube. We're super close to getting 1,000 subscribers. And if we can get that done this week, if we can actually get us to 1,000 subscribers, I'll do a giveaway of some audiobook codes afterwards. So just, you know, go check us out on YouTube. If you haven't subscribed to us there, go do so. You'll get the audio, you'll get a little bit of your podcast there, notifications whenever something is new out from us, whether it's an author interview or this show or the audiobook podcast, whatever else. And you can catch us on YouTube, including, you know, little time codes where you can click on them to just see the reviews that you want to check out. So there you go. But if you want to support us in any way, other shape or form, folks, you can find all the ways to do so at litrpgpodcast.com/support. But again, thanks for listening. Thank you for watching. I really do appreciate you guys taking the time to listen to me talk about this thing I love, LitRPG, and comment and just communicate with me and the community and tell me the things you love, the things you don't agree with on my reviews. They're all really helpful ways to engage in the community. I love talking to people who love LitRPG, just like me. So until we can hang out again, though, folks, remember to go read some LitRPG. Goodbye, everybody.